Good evening. This is Pastor Helen down in Sebring, Florida. I invite you to join us tonight as we dig into the Word of God. It says that in 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is given. And it also tells us we're to study. We're to study so that we know. I mean, I was asked the question this week, how do you know if it's God speaking to you or if it's the devil speaking to you? How do you tell the difference? And this person wanted to read a book, and she heard a voice that said, don't read that book. She wanted to know whether or not that was God speaking or not. And I asked what the name of the book was, and she told me the name of the book. And it just so happens that I picked that book up at our thrift shop and took it to my home, and I had it there when we were discussing this. And I said, this is a good book. It would not be God telling you not to read it. God wants us to learn. He doesn't want us ignorant. He doesn't want us in the dark. But the voice of the enemy is so close to the voice of God. You see, everything that God does, the enemy will try to duplicate one way or the other. I mean, even from the very beginning, when Satan came in the garden, he tried to take God's words away. He says, has God said? That's how the enemy does things. He puts a little doubt in our mind, confuses us, but we go back to the book, the Holy Word of God, and that determines whether it's truth or not. We can have men teach us, we can have all kind of people teach us, but if it isn't in the Word of God, you need to throw it away. Because all scripture is given by inspiration of God for doctrine, for reproof, and instruction in righteousness, that the man and the women, good evening Deborah, that the, and Barbara, good evening, glad to have you with us, that the man and woman of God can be thoroughly furnished. That means you're not living in an apartment that's empty. He wants your spirit to be filled up with the Word of God. But in order to do that, you have to know what it says. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. And how do you hear without a preacher? And how do you have a preacher unless he said it or she said it? See, God doesn't want us in the dark. So we're to study. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
That's just a little introduction. Now we're going to talk a little bit about the book of Daniel again. Daniel was very young when he was taken into captivity. Jeremiah, Isaiah, they'd all prophesied these things were going to happen, and he was taken down into Babylon. They were told, don't fight against it. If you do, you'll die. Jeremiah said that. But if you go down there and you wait until God says it's time to be able to go back home, you'll be all right. So Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, and Daniel, some of the best of the best, were taken down there, and God elevated them. In spite of being in the enemy's camp, God used them. Have you ever felt like you were in the enemy's camp?
Yeah.
You might say, Pastor, what are you talking about? You ever had a job where everybody around you was against the things of God? How about family? How about family where they don't want to hear about Jesus? Or if you pray, they say, well, you're offending people. How about when you just go anywhere or even listen to the news? You hear all this stuff. You see, we are in the enemy's camp because Satan is in the world, and we're in the world, but we're not of the world. We're of God. So because we are of God, we can overcome. But Daniel was taken down there, and God gifted him. He was young. God gifted him just like he's gifted some of you. God has gifted you with great things, and he wants you to use those gifts right where you're at. Don't get frustrated in your work. Don't get frustrated with your family. Don't try to push things on people. You have to love them. Daniel just was obedient to God. He could interpret dreams. And the king came to him several times. Chapter 5 that we finished last week the grandson of King Nebuchadnezzar, threw a party. He took all of the special things that God had in the temple, the anointed things, the set apart, the holy things, and brought them into this party. Isn't that like what the devil does? He wants to take the things of God and steal them from us, and then expose them and use them and make mockery of it. I'm telling you right now, I've seen things of Jesus that were statues that ridiculed who he was and mocked who he was. Don't be surprised at this. That's what Satan's job is. What do you mean he has a job? That's what he does. He's going to try to steal, to kill, and destroy. But God said in his word that he brings you life, John 10:10, and life more abundantly. He wants you to have the best. So there Daniel is. You bring him in, and the grandson says, well, what is this handwriting on the wall? He said, I'll tell you what it is. Your time's up. Daniel had told the grandfather that these things were going to happen, and God gave some time. There wasn't any change. You know, you can grow up in a Christian home. You can even be under the influence of Christian parents. But when you make your choice to go the other way, God isn't going to take a big stick or a restraining order and push you back in. God is a God that allows us free will. People say, well, why do bad things happen to good people? Because of free will. If he judged every sinner, he'd have to judge us too. And we couldn't do that. That'll come later. Things are rough. But I'm telling you, when God sets a time, it's going to happen. And Belshazzar, he saw these words, Mene, Mene, Tekel, Upharsin. And that was the handwriting on the wall. It means your day is numbered and finished. You see, there comes a time when the enemy's plans will be struck down by God. And he was taken out. I want you to look at chapter 5. This is some review. In chapter 5, we will look at verses 25 through 31. And this is the writing that was written. Mene, Mene, Tekel, Upharsin. And Daniel's given the interpretation. How would you like to be Daniel? You see, Daniel didn't worry. He knew if he died where he's going, he'd seen Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego thrown into the fiery furnace. He just knew God was going to take care of him. Some of you out there have a lot of fear. Let it go. God will take care of us. He's Jehovah Jireh. He's your provider. Don't worry about how it's going to happen. It will. God said he would take care of you. Mene, mene, tekel, upharsin. God hath numbered thy kingdom and finished it. Oops. Then it says tekel. That means thou art weighed in the balances and are found wanting. In other words, like the weights in a courtroom. The evidence is against you, sir, and you're going down. Then it says, Perez, thy kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. He heard this. He could have destroyed Daniel. I don't want to hear what you have to say. Have you ever been like that? Has anybody approached you to try to tell you that some things needed to change in your life? Maybe you've told people that and they don't like it. Daniel didn't come in there with a haughty spirit. He went in there with the presence of God on him, and they recognized it was God speaking. So look at verse 29. Then commanded Belshazzar, and they clothed Daniel with scarlet. Here's this guy telling him that it's finished, tonight's done, but he elevates him. How about us? Do we elevate people when they come against us, or do we want to see them struck down? They clothed Daniel with scarlet, put a chain of gold about his neck, and made a proclamation concerning him that he should be the third ruler in the kingdom. There it is. He had said that earlier. He was going to make that person it, and he kept his word, even knowing he was going downhill. That's amazing to me. 30. In that night was Belshazzar, the king of the Chaldeans, slain. That was the end of him. That was the end of that family line. That was the end of their kingdom. And Darius, the Median, took the kingdom, being about 62 years old. That's 62 years old. He was a young guy. But you remember last week, if you watched it, 2 years they waited outside the kingdom for the right time. 2 years. Wow. That enemy of Belshazzar was out there waiting for the right time. And see, when it was the right time, the kingdom went down. They came in when they were drunk. But God used them to judge them for their sin. You don't get away with messing with God's stuff. You can't take it into your hands and bring revenge. You can't be the one to do it. But if God tells you something, you go with what God has to say. Now we're going to go into chapter 6. Now Daniel had been elevated before. The first king elevated him after the dreams. Then he's kind of out in the pasture, so to speak. He'd been put back. People forgot about him. Years go by, many years. Now he's an older man. He's not some kid anymore. And this new king is on the scene. You never know what's going to happen with somebody new. You never know in our own country what's going to happen. You just have to pray for him. I know Daniel prayed for the kingdom that he was under. Look at verse 1. It pleased Darius, that's the king, he was one of the maids, to set over the kingdom 120 princes, which should be over the whole kingdom. You see, it wasn't just a little town, it was a big area. It was huge, the Medes and the Persians, the areas that they had. In verse 2 says, and over these three presidents, of whom Daniel was first. Ah, here's Daniel elevated again, that the princes might give a counsel unto them and the king should have no damage. In other words, he put people in charge that he felt like he could trust. Do you imagine during those 2 years, seated outside the wall, that Darius heard what was going on in there? I'm sure reports they had spies that got in there somehow. It doesn't say that, but he had to have known about Daniel. When you go and take over a country, you're not going to elevate somebody that you think is an enemy. Am I right? Can I get an amen on that?
Amen.
That's the truth. So he must have heard about him. So here Daniel is put up in charge, one of three. And the king should have no damage. He trusted him. There wasn't going to be any loss. He'd come in, taken the kingdom. Belshazzar's dead. Verse 3. Then this Daniel, this Barbara, this Deborah, this Echo, whoever it is, this Daniel was preferred above the presidents and princes. Why? Oh, because he had the nicest clothes. No. Because he was a dreamer. No, because he could interpret dreams. No, because he was a child of the Jewish people. No, it says because an excellent spirit was in him. See what promotes you, people? Isn't all your gifts. It isn't your money. It isn't your last name. It isn't your title. It was the excellent spirit. Daniel had an excellent spirit. Back in chapter 5, the queen's mother had heard of Daniel from the years earlier. She brought him in. He had a good reputation. He had a good spirit about him. We should have love for our enemies, folks. We should despise sin, but love the sinner. Daniel had an excellent spirit in him, verse 3, and the king's thought to set him over the whole realm. That's a pretty big position, isn't it? King goes in, he gets everything. But he trusted Daniel because of the excellent spirit. When you have an excellent spirit, you're not going to get upset over every little thing. Anybody ever get upset? You ever get upset over anything? Oh, I'm telling you, that excellent spirit is what God's looking for. Somebody that's going to be different than the rest. Somebody that isn't looking for the bad in everybody around them. Somebody that has an excellent spirit. He wanted to put him over the whole realm. Now that was a pretty big job. Verse 4. And it sounds like the same story from previous chapters. Then the presidents and princes sought to find occasion against Daniel concerning the kingdom. 120. It says he had 120. Three presidents were there, but 120 princes, which would be over the whole kingdom. You know, there were 120 in the upper room. And they weren't looking for reasons not to be there. They were looking for God. But this 120, what does it say? They wanted to find something against Daniel concerning the kingdom. I'm here to tell you, when you start coming against ministries, when you start coming against people, when you start speaking against them, you better be careful, because that's God's place. It's not our place to put on Facebook everybody else's dirty laundry. Hello? Because I guarantee we all have some. You look into my past and your past, there's plenty of dirty laundry out there. But they're looking for something to get Daniel on. If they didn't like it, they were jealous. You ever been jealous when somebody got promoted that you didn't feel should get promoted? That can happen. I've seen it in ministries. I've seen people faithful for years, and then they bring some young person in, and the young person gets promoted instead. It's not an easy thing to be a Christian and have an excellent spirit. So they're looking for something to find occasion against them. But listen what it said. But they could find none occasion nor fault. Wow. What a word that is. To not find any fault in somebody. Wow. An excellent spirit. They couldn't find anything that he did wrong. All those years that he was there, they couldn't find anything wrong. It says, for much as he was faithful. Oh, there's that word faithful. Faithful. You see, people determine whether you're successful, how big you are, how many people follow you, how many people are in your church, how many times you prophesy, how many times you do this, how many times you do it. That isn't what God's looking for either. Daniel was faithful. That's why they couldn't find anything wrong. What an attribute, faithfulness. Neither was there any error or fault found in him. You know, Jesus was like that. They tried to find fault in Jesus, and they couldn't find anything. So what did they do? They hired somebody to lie. And the religious people come up with all this stuff. Mm-hmm. And then they hired people, and Jesus eventually was crucified. And it wasn't the Romans that crucified Jesus. It was you and me. Our sin. So Daniel was a type of Christ here. It said they could find no error or fault in him. They didn't like it. They wanted to be in charge. Have you ever wanted to be in charge and you weren't? That's not a good spirit. An excellent spirit means you submit. Submit to those above you. And Daniel had done that all those years. Jeremiah said, do it and you'll live. And now here he is, being promoted again. Verse 5. Then said these men, how would you like 120 talking against you? You ever felt like that? I bet some of you watching have felt that way, haven't you? It said, then said these men, we shall not find any occasion against this Daniel, except we find it against him concerning the law of his God. People are watching us. People are watching to see whether we're going to slip up. They have a real devil out there trying to set a trap. Maybe you're the one used to set a trap at times. Be careful. Said then these presidents and princes assembled together the king. And they came up with a plan. And they said thus unto him, King Darius, can't you just hear them? Live forever. That kind of flattery that makes you sick. You ever met people that come up, oh, you look so nice. And you know when they walk away, they're talking about you. It's that kind of character. King Darius, live forever. All the presidents of the kingdom, the governors and the princes and the counselors and the captains have consulted together to establish a royal statute and make a firm decree. In other words, we've all come together for something good for you, king. See, that flattery sometimes will get you into trouble. And they said that whosoever shall ask a petition of any god or man for 30 days, save of thee, O king, he should be cast into the den of lions. In other words, they can't pray or ask anything except to you. Now, Daniel prayed 3 times a day. Probably prayed all day long. So they're trying to set up because they know Daniel had an excellent spirit. And he's not going to not do what's right. He knew who to talk to get the answers. You don't just go to your pastor, you go to the one that pastored your pastor, Jesus. Amen?
Mm.
So now in verse 8, Daniel's going to be set up. They're hoping he's going to fall so they can get his job. Hello? Now will king establish the decree and sign the writing that it be not changed according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which all are not. You see, the law of the Medes and Persians was this. When they established the law that or decree, that was it. It couldn't be changed. They knew that. And they knew if they set it up, he couldn't change it. They wanted to destroy Daniel. Now, O king, establish the decree. 9. Wherefore, King Darius signed the writing and the decree. He was set up. Sometimes we do something out of flattery. We do something that we haven't thought through. Hello? We go along with something that's not really the best thing to do. Verse 10. Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house. See, he saw what they did. He didn't go in there and say, just kill all these people. No. He went into his house and his windows being open in his chamber, he didn't hide. The windows were open towards Jerusalem. He knew where his home was. God's window is open. And when we pray to God, he hears. And he kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day and prayed. Uh-oh, there goes that petition that he wasn't supposed to make to anybody but King Darius. And gave thanks before his God as he did aforetime. In other words, he wasn't double-minded. He didn't go along with the crowd. I remember being young, I was saved, but I was carnal. And I didn't want my friends to think I was different. Have you ever been that way? And when somebody talked about God that was a friend and others were around, I kind of just went the opposite way. And I had to repent of that. You need to stay with God and you can't go wrong. Praise God.
Praise God.
So here he is. He's doing what he always did. He didn't go in there and hide. He opened the window up so they could see him. I tell you what, if a law came down and we couldn't pray, are you going to run and hide in the woods? Are you going to just do what God would have you do every day and others see it? That's quite a question, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
You alone can answer that one. Verse 11, then these men assembled and found Daniel praying and making a supplication before his God. See, they were waiting for the opportunity to destroy him. That's what Satan does, folks. He's going to look for every opportunity that he can destroy you in one way or the other. He's going to look for it. He's going to find ways to get to you. And there Daniel's praying, verse 12. Then they came near and spoke before the king concerning the king's decree. You see, they set Daniel up, and now they're going to try to destroy him. Ah, king, verse 12, hast thou not signed a decree that every man that shall ask a petition of any god or man within 30 days, save of thee, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions? Had God said, just like Satan. The king answered and said, the thing is true, according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which all are not. Yep, I did that. I sure did sign that. Then answered they and said before the king, that Daniel, which is of the children of the captivity of Judah, what it put down. They didn't say Daniel, the one in charge. They didn't say Daniel, the one you made ruler. No, he's one of them. Put down. He's not one of us, O king. We didn't do it. Of course not. They probably didn't pray at all. Am I right? That's for sure. He says, that Daniel, which is of the children of the captivity of Judah, regardeth not thee, O king, nor the decree that thou hast signed, but makes his petition three times a day. Go look at what he's doing over there. Then the king, when he heard these words, was sore displeased with himself. Have you ever done something and you're sorry you did it? Because you could see what was really going to happen because you made the wrong choices? Now the king is seeing what he did. He's sore displeased with himself and set his heart or made up his mind to deliver Daniel. And he labored till the going down of the sun to deliver him. Now I want you to know, he loved Daniel. Why? Because of that excellent spirit. You see, have you ever just met somebody that just radiated the love of God? You just wanted to be around them because you could just feel God in their presence. That's what God wants us to become. Not some mighty preacher, not some mighty teacher. A mighty lover of God with an excellent spirit. Not judgmental. Not pointing fingers. Not quick to accuse. That excellent, faithful spirit. What did the king do? He labored, made up his mind. He tried to do something until the sun went down. Then these men assembled unto the king and said, O king, let me remind you of this. He says, know, O king, that the law of the Medes and Persians is that no decree nor statute with the king established may be changed. Can't you just see him inside going, I wish I had done this. I see what's going to happen. And there these men are with their mocking, prideful spirits. Okay, and you signed it. Now you've got to do it. That's how Satan comes against us. He never plays fair. Ever. Don't think for a minute when you dabble into something of the dark side that he is going to use that to trap you for your entire life. So, now back in verse 16. Then the king commanded, and they brought Daniel, and they cast him in the den of lions. And I imagine the lions were pretty hungry. They hadn't eaten anybody but recently. How about it? You ever felt like you were being thrown in a den of lions and you want to claw your way out? Sometimes those are the ones we work with, aren't they? Sometimes they're family members, aren't they? Now the king spoke and said unto Daniel, thy God whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee. See, he'd been watching Daniel. He saw that excellent spirit in him. He saw that he's faithful to his God. He knew about the dreams that had been interpreted, all of these things, and they couldn't find anything wrong with Daniel. And now the king that didn't serve that God is saying, your God's going to take care of you. I'm here to tell you that when we go through hard times, there'll be people encouraging us to say, you know what? God's going to take care of it. He's going to take care of Rita and Barbara and everybody else that's watching. He's going to take care of Anton. He's going to take care of Deborah when the hard times come. He's going to take care of Edward and Bonnie. He's going to take care of me. That's what the king is saying. Thy God whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee. And a stone was brought and laid upon the mouth of the den. See, he had to do what he did because the law cannot be changed. He put him in there where the lions were at and put a stone so Daniel couldn't get out. And the king sealed it with his own signet and with the signet of his lords that the purpose might not be changed concerning Daniel. He put it in writing. He didn't know what would happen, other than he believed that Daniel's God would take care of him. He loved Daniel. But look at 18. Then the king went to his palace and passed the night Bad-mouthing Daniel? Is that what it says? No. Bad-mouthing anybody? No, it says fasting. Sometimes, when your friends or somebody that loves God is in a hard place, you're the one that needs to fast for them. Because Jesus himself said that these sometimes don't come out unless you have fasting and prayer. So here's this king that was a medium. He was not a Christian. He was not a Jew. He's fasting and praying. It says neither were instruments of music brought before him, and his sleep went from him. In other words, he spent all night fasting and praying for Daniel. He'd signed the decree, realized it was the wrong thing, but he's going to intercede for him. Then, neither were instruments of music brought. There wasn't any party time. Sometimes we just need to get along with God for our friends and pray for them. We don't know. Verse 19, then the king arose very early in the morning and went in haste unto the den of lions. He just was expecting something to happen. I'm going to tell you, that's faith. When I moved to Florida years ago, I had a business. And I was told that in the summer in Florida, that business would go down because it would depend upon the Yankees. And I said, no, I'm not going to believe that for 1 minute, because someone tells me. I want to read that to you. Maybe the king had had somebody read it to him. Turn to Psalms chapter 1. Be careful what you say with your mouth. It says here, now, the king had been listening to Daniel. Listen to what it says. Blessed is the man, verse 1 of Psalm 1, that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. See, the ungodly had come to that king. The ungodly had set him up and set Daniel up. It says, blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law, or the word of the Lord, and in his law, or word, does he meditate day and night. Now look at verse 3. He shall be like a tree, planted by the rivers of water, that brings forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Mm. And when I stood on that scripture, we had a wonderful summer. I want you to turn to Jeremiah chapter 17. Jeremiah before Daniel. Jeremiah chapter 17. If you listen to the right counsel, you won't have any problems. The king listened to ungodly counsel. Now he sees what he did wrong, so he's trying to make up for it by fasting and praying. Some of us have made mistakes in our life, but God has a better plan for us. And when we intercede, we can change things. Jeremiah 17, verse 7. Well, let's start with 5. It says, thus saith the Lord, cursed be the man that trusteth in man and makes flesh his armor, and whose heart departs from the Lord. For he shall be like the heath in the desert, shall not see when good cometh, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness and the salt land and not inhabit it. That's a pretty bad place to be, folks. That's when you don't trust God. But look at verse 7. Blessed is the man that trusts in the Lord and whose hope the Lord is. Wow, do you trust in the Lord tonight? Can I get an amen?
Yes, amen.
Is your hope in the Lord tonight? Can I get an amen?
Yes.
It said, he shall be as a tree planted by waters, and that spreads out her roots by the river, and shall not see or fear when heat comes, but her leaf shall be green, and shall not be careful in the year of drought, not worry in the year of drought, neither shall cease from yielding fruit.
No.
I'm here to tell you, even a year of drought, God's going to bring forth things in our life. God wants us to prosper and be in health, even as our soul prospers. Daniel knew these promises, and the king knew Daniel. I'm telling you, whatever it is in your life that the enemy is telling you you can't do, and God said you will, you say, you're a liar, devil. I'm going to go on with God. Amen.
Amen.
Yes. Now back to chapter 6. The king went to the palace and fasted during the night. He rose up early in the morning, went in haste under the den of lions. He was expecting something good to happen. Do you expect it in summer in Florida? Do you expect it in winter in Michigan? How about it, folks? Are you expecting, well, you know, we live in Florida, we gotta expect things we will. That's a lie from hell. It isn't Florida that brings your income in. It isn't Michigan, it's God. Amen. He is our source of life. He is our source of health. He is our source of income. He is our all in all. So the king ran there in haste, expecting to see God's move in Daniel's life. Verse 20. When he came to the den, he cried with a lamentable voice, Daniel, oh Daniel, servant of the living God. Oh, he knew who Daniel's God was. Not some dead stone, not some altar. Ah, Daniel served a living God. And there's King Darius. He said, Daniel, oh Daniel, servant of the living God. We're in Daniel chapter 6, verse 20. Is thy God, whom thou servest continually, able to deliver thee from the lions? He's waiting and listening. Then said Daniel unto the king, O king, live forever. Whoa! The prayers are being answered. My God has sent his angel, and hath shut the lion's mouth. What is it in your life that you need to have God shut the lion's mouth on? Maybe it's some mouths that need to be shut that speak against you. Don't you try to do it. You let God do it. It says that they have not hurt me. For as much as before him, innocency was found in me. When you're innocent before God, I'm telling you, he's going to come through for you people. Some of you have been struggling. You've been faithful. But God's here to tell you, keep that excellent spirit. Stay faithful and he will bring you through all those enemies, the lack, the financial enemies, the ones that are trying to pull you down and bite you and destroy you. God is saying to you tonight, you stand before God innocent. He says, he was found innocency in me, and also before thee, O king, have I done no hurt. I didn't do anything wrong. Then was the king exceeding glad for him and commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. Oh, God comes through every time. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no manner of hurt was found upon him because he believed in his God.
Amen.
You see, faith. Faith is what we walk by. One of the things Jesus said, when I come back, will I find any faith? Mm. Yes, you will. I'm going to be one of them, and so are you. How about the rest of you here? Are you going to be ones that are following
Amen.
Faith?
Amen.
Yes. And the king commanded, and they brought those men which had accused Daniel, and they cast them into the den of lions, them, their children, their wives, and the lions had the mastery of them. They didn't know they were going to be invited to dinner, did they? Huh. And broke all their bones in pieces, or ever they came at the bottom of the den. You see, God has the final word against the enemies. Don't you stop having an excellent spirit. Don't you stop doing what God's called you to do, because God's going to come through. 25. Then King Darius wrote unto all people, nations and languages that dwell in all the earth. Whoa! That's quite a bunch of letters that went out. Peace be multiplied unto you. I make a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom, men tremble in fear before the God of Daniel. Wow! What a decree. When you lift God up, he'll draw all men unto you. He lifted God up. God brought that king up. Oh, it makes me want to cry. And he says, for he is the living God and steadfast forever in his kingdom, that which shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall be even unto the end. He delivereth and rescueth, and he works signs and wonders in heaven and in earth, who hath delivered Daniel from the power of the lions. So this Daniel prospered in the reign of Darius and in the reign of Cyrus the Persian. And I'm here to tell you tonight, some of you have been going through some hard times. People have spoken against you. Don't lose the excellent spirit. Don't even worry about what they're saying. If you stand innocent before God, He's going to deliver you from that. He will take care of you. He will bring you through. I'm here to tell you that God loves you tonight. And I'm so glad that you joined us. Next week, we're going to go into the chapter 7. But tonight, I just want to speak God's blessing over you. Father, I ask that you touch each one within the sound of my voice. Touch them. Those that come in late tonight, Lord, let them hear this message because I know it's going to encourage them. God, you have a plan for each one. Let us keep that excellent spirit that Daniel had. Let us be faithful like Daniel. Let us always go before God in innocency. He didn't put his enemies down. He didn't talk against the enemies. He lifted God up, and because God was lifted up, the king brought favor for Daniel. God bless you tonight. Until next week, this is Pastor Helen saying good night.